So, ladies and gentlemen, welcome. My name is Dr. Ian Henderson. I am the director of the Menzies Centre for Australian Studies. You'll hear more about me at the end. I just want to do a quick welcome. To let you know, we are working on making the room cooler, so hopefully it will cool down as we continue and enjoy all the hot air that we're going to hear about. I'm here just to start simply to introduce to you Professor Ed Byrne, the principal and president of King's College London. He's a former Monash man and Australian, so I think we can give him an extra rousing welcome. Professor Ed Byrne.
Thank you very much, Ian, and it's a real pleasure to be here for a cricketing occasion. Those of you who are good on accents, so I think there's almost everybody, can realise that I have a slight Northern England twinge because my family were 10-pound migrants in the mid-60s. So for years I had this ambivalence, should I support England or Australia in the cricket? And I'm not an easy-to-change person, so for decades it was England. But I think about 20 years ago, my eldest boy said to me, "Dad, you've been in Australia so long, time you changed." And I did. So So the title of the event tonight is Culture Wars, the Ashes and National Character, and it's co-hosted by Australian Business and King's College's Menzies Centre for Australian Studies. Look, I'll just say a word about our speakers because Jacquelin Magnay is going to introduce them in more detail. But it's an absolute delight to have the Honourable John Howard here, Prime Minister of Australia for a long, long time. But in his own words, and I remember this, a cricket tragic, so we couldn't have anybody better tonight. And also, of course, Mrs. Jeanette Howard, and I think your sons, Tim and Richard, might be here also, if they are welcome. Sir Howard Davies, a colleague, former head of our neighbour, the LSE, chairman of the Royal Bank of Scotland, but more importantly tonight, he still plays cricket for Barnes Common and Powerstock and Hook cricket clubs, and I think his captain may be somewhere in the audience. Gideon Haigh, English, Australian, right. Gideon Haigh, English-born Australian journalist, author of numerous books on cricket. I well remember reading his book, The Summer Game, years ago, wonderful book. And he's written wonderful words about cricket in a series of other books. Jim Maxwell, AM, of course, well known to all of us who listen to cricket on the ABC, frequent member of the BBC's Test Match Special. He's been editor of the ABC's cricket magazine since 88. Is the author of Ashes from Bodyline to War and many other contributions about cricket. Thinking of Jim, I remember as a boy listening to Alan McGilvray and Lindsay Hassett as John Snow was demolishing the Australian Test side in Sydney. I hadn't changed my allegiance at that time, so I quite enjoyed that game. Jacquelin Magnay is our moderator. Jacquelin is a Walkley Award-winning sports journalist. She was the Olympics editor for the Telegraph Media Group and is currently the European editor for the Australian newspaper. Now, I'd also like to mention Sir Timothy Lawrence, the Honourable Alexander Downer, High Commissioner for Australia, the Honourable Martin Foley. Martin, great to see you here, Victorian Minister for Creative Industries, the Agent General, certainly for Victoria and Queensland, possibly other states, and our sponsors, Westpac. Look, I don't want to say much about King's, that's not why we're here. King's is a world top 20 university now. We have about 50 Nobel laureates, and many of the great people in human thought were here. But a particular thing about King's in recent years has been the establishment of international centres. So we have a China centre, a Brazil centre, a Russia centre, a US centre, an India centre. And in Australia, we have the Menzies Centre, which is co-hosting tonight, and Ian Henderson, of course, is the director. This is one of the oldest and most dynamic research and teaching centres for Australian history and culture in the world. It is, of course, named after Sir Robert Menzies, Australia's longest-serving PM. It's been with King's since 1999, and it's particularly appropriate to note tonight that the endowment was granted the college by the Howard government. So we're particularly delighted to welcome John Howard, Australia's second longest-serving Prime Minister. The Menzies Centre introduces students at King's to Australian history, politics and culture, and there's an absolutely outstanding activity. And it's very good to mention, to welcome John Douth and most of the board of the Menzies here tonight also. This year, the Menzies has thrown its doors open to a wider public, aiming to become a major forum for the promotion of Australian ideas, business, politics and culture. And this is not least through its conversations program, bringing experts together to discuss issues topical to Britons and Australians. So with that theme, I'm really pleased to see in the audience the speakers from our first conversation, John McFarlane, the chairman of Barclays, and David Morgan, very eminent banker also, head of the private equity group JC Flowers & Co., and now more importantly, head of our investment committee here at King's. So I understand the first session was a superb discussion of financial sector reform. And as with that last conversation tonight, we're delighted to be working in collaboration with Australian Business, an organisation which brings together professionals and companies who have Australian interests and connections through business networking opportunities and events. So a special welcome then to their members, and a big thank you to Catherine Batterby and her team for their support this evening. So I hope you enjoy this discussion and join us afterwards for a reception. I've nearly finished. The reception will be in the Great Hall, which is next door. Thank you to Negociant, who have supplied the wine, and I guess we'll have more spirited conversation on the ashes. So I'll now hand over to our moderator, Jackie Magnay, and thank you all for coming tonight.
Check that this microphone's working okay. Good evening, everyone. My name's Jacquelin Magnay, and I'm the European correspondent for the Australian newspaper. I'd like to introduce you to the panel today. We're very privileged to have Mr. John Howard, the former Prime Minister of Australia, and a new author about a subject he knows dear, long-serving prime ministers in Australia. We also have Sir Howard Davies, an expert in financial regulation and now airports. He's the incoming chair of the Royal Bank of Scotland. He's a fan of the Lancashire County Cricket Club. So I'm looking forward to some insights about Jimmy Anderson and Mike Atherton later. He also still plays for Barnes Common. Mr. Jim Maxwell, AM, the chief ABC cricket commentator, who has been behind the microphone for 43 years. That's 276 test matches. That's quite an amazing figure. President of the primary club in Australia, which helps disabled children, and is also the president of Eastern Suburbs Cricket Club, which has members David Warner, Brad Haddon, now Peter Neville as well, and a little bit controversial, Sam Robson, of course, the English cricketer. Mr. Gideon Haigh, who has authored 31 books, 20 favourite subjects, on his favourite subject of cricket, of course, and whose columns in The Times and The Australian are always insightful and a must-read. Now, when I was researching this topic of culture wars in cricket, I googled, of course, cricket and culture, and up popped 40 different subheadings. There was Shane Warne, of course. Now, his contribution to culture is mind-boggling, to say the least. The Beige Brigade, which I thought was an endearing reference to the very much loved Richie Beno, until I realised it's actually a colloquial term for New Zealand cricket fans. And, of course, Peter the Cat, the famous Mog of Marylebone, who preened before the cameras in 1960s, and he's a worthy cultural emblem too. But, of course, some of Australia and Britain's greatest prime ministers have been cultural ambassadors too, and I can immediately think of Sir Robert Menzies and John Major. But we have here John Howard, and your famous tagline is not the highly prestigious Order of Merit as bestowed by the Queen to only 24 people in the world, but as CT, cricket tragic. Now, tell me, how did you get that official title?
Blame Mark Taylor. What happened was when Mark got his magnificent 334 at Peshawar in 1998, Col Allen, then the editor of the Sydney Daily Telegraph, put on a lunch to welcome him back. He asked me to speak. I got up and said Mark was terrific and all that sort of stuff you'd expect, and which he was. and his graciousness in retiring at 334, of course, same score that Bradman had got, Mark got up and said, the Prime Minister is the sort of person who in our dressing room we describe as a cricket tragic. What that really means is that his ability to play the game varies in inverse proportion to his passion for it. And of course, in relation to me, that's right. Look, this subject is endless. I'm interested that with some of the examples you threw up from your Google. When I think of the cultural impact of Australia on cricket, of course, I've got to declare that I come at this subject as a very unreliable witness, in that I was born and bred into a family that loved cricket. I can assure Jim that I started hearing and loving cricket courtesy of ABC Radio in 1946, when Wally Hammond led the MCC, as they were then generally called, to Australia for the first post-war series. And it commenced a love affair with the game. And over the years, I think of the contest between Australia and England as a marvellous sort of a metaphor for that ambiguous relationship that our two countries have. I have never seen in sporting contests more spectator venom than I've seen in English, England and Australia contests. Not only incidentally cricket, but years ago when I was much younger, I stood on the Sydney Cricket Ground Hill when it existed in a rugby league test in the 1960s between Australia and Great Britain, at a time when Great Britain could field a decent rugby league team, which of course you can't now. And the vitriol and the venom was quite extraordinary. And of course, we all know from the history of our game the passion that was generated in the 1930s because of the Bodyline series. I don't think it's an exaggeration to say that part of the genius of Bradman was the extraordinary cultural lift that he gave to our country. And that was magnified because he became such a hate figure to the doyens of English cricket, which is why they invented Bodyline to try and restrict him. And of course, in more recent years, one of the things that has struck me is that some of the cultural differences between our two countries has certainly come out in the performance of the teams on the field. We recently mourned the loss of Richie Beno. Now, Richie Beno was probably the best-known cricket name in Australia after Don Bradman, and arguably in many other parts of the world as well. I think Beno's greatest contribution to cricket was the spirit he brought to the captaincy of Australia when he took over in 1958. 1958 was a series, of course, when Peter May brought the MCC to Australia, and one of the opening batsmen was Trevor Barnacle Bailey. And I think to get 150 runs in a day, the spectators felt they were being very well treated. And it was just quite funereal. And Beno, I think, was responsible for the practice we just take for granted now, that when somebody gets a wicket, everybody races up and hugs the bloke and kisses them on the cheek or whatever, and carries on as though something like that has never happened before. I think Richie Beno started that. And of course, his contribution and to the lifting of the game in Australia during that famous tour of Australia in 1960-61 from the West Indies, and the camaraderie between him and the late Frank Worrell was quite remarkable. Because another character that has done so much for cricket and did it in such an Australian way was Kerry Packer. Packer had a remarkable impact. I mean, the hostility towards Packer, not only in English cricketing circles, but also in Australian cricketing circles, was quite amazing. But when you look back on the contribution that he made, it is quite amazing. And he brought a particular Australian character to it. I remember one of the things that I felt I should do as part of my portfolio of responsibilities as Prime Minister that whenever I went to Adelaide when I was Prime Minister, I would call on Don Bradman while he was alive and have a chat inevitably about the world and about cricket. And I remember him saying to me in his very considered way what an extraordinary boost 50-over cricket had been to Test cricket, how it had altered the attitude of the players, the fielding skills had been enhanced, and it had made an enormous contribution. And he said, you know, as a result of that, we have a lot to sort of thank one day cricket for. I think deep down the passionate rivalry between our two countries is one of the most endearing things about the Anglo-Australian relationship. And I don't think it's dimmed, it's altered over the years. I find, though, whenever I come to this country, a special resonance in the rivalry that does exist between our two countries. Now, do we play cricket differently? Yes, we do, but not so differently as to alter the the basic continuity of the game and the contribution the culture of the two countries has brought to it. I'm obviously coming off four marvellous days at Lord's. But of course I needed four marvellous days at Lord's, because the last time I'd been at Lord's, they were three dreadful days. And so it is just a reminder of all of that. But in case we take the vitriol and the venom too seriously, let me remind you that a few months ago, the Lowy Institute, a think tank in Australia, founded by that great man, Frank Lowy, conducted its annual warmth poll. And this is when you ask people in the survey to say whether they have a warm, very warm or cold attitude towards various countries, and believe it or not, and it must mean that no cricket followers were included in the sample, the last time that poll was conducted, it showed that New Zealand and Britain were still the two countries in the world that Australians felt the warmest about. So perhaps that is a nice way to end my comments. Thank you.
The linguistic nuances are quite extraordinary, I find, in that ice blocks are lollies, lollies are sweeties, chips are crisps. And I thought, do the two countries talk a different language? Now, we've had Mr. Howard here say that we have an endearing relationship, Sir Howard Davies. Do you think that's an endearing relationship between Australia and England?
Well, first of all, since we're supposed to be in a cultured environment, good evening. Or for the Australian listeners, g'day, in case that wasn't understood. I think that John must be right that the two countries still have some affection for each other, though I recall, and here one of my sons who is here will immediately start to seize up with embarrassment, but when my two sons were small, we didn't at home give them military toys. It wasn't a big thing about it, we just didn't happen to. So they had no facility with playing with tanks or planes. But we were around when they were about 5 and 8 with some other friends who had children a bit older, and after lunch, you know, they dug out a box and it was full of toys, of tanks and planes and whatever. And they, fine, they disappeared off into another room, they got all this stuff out, and when we were about to leave, I was there, they were engrossed in this, and they were playing themselves against some imaginary enemy, was the way they did it. And there was a fleet all destroyed, quite clearly. You know, they made a real mess of this. And I went in and I said, oh, I said, you know, you've done a job on the German fleet, haven't you? And they looked at me sort of blankly. And I said, well, who is it? And they said, well, it's the Australian Navy. Because they had been brought up to think that they were the natural enemy. I'm proud of the way I brought up my children. But as I walked in this evening, Ros Kelly said it was good of you to come. And Normally, of course, as an English word person, one would say, oh, no, no, don't think of it, but actually I think it is. In two ways. One, as Ed referred to, I used to be the director of the LSE. The LSE and Kings have a certain dogs and cats kind of relationship. We always regarded this place as Strand Polytechnic. So it's pretty decent of me to slum it over here for an evening. But also, when I agreed, of course, the Ashes was still to be begun, and then we had Cardiff, and I thought this was going to be a rather amusing evening. But, of course, that couldn't be allowed, and it's quite clear what happened at Lord's, that David Morgan and his other moneyed Australian bankers clearly bought the groundsmen, the umpires, and all members of the English team except Alistair Cook. I actually thought after the first innings that Ben Stokes had not been bought, but when he in his absurd run out in the second innings, I realised he was indeed in on the deal. However, we press on and let's hope for something better at Edgbaston. But I was asked to talk about the Ashes and national character. Some might say that the phrase Australian national character is an oxymoron. I wouldn't be among them. But I looked for ways of defining Australianness, and let me quote you from one intelligent, thoughtful, and rather objective observer. That Australians themselves are extraordinarily sensitive to criticism is a fact which any visitor to their country will have discovered for himself. Unlike most Englishmen, the Australian, while impatient of criticism from without, is not given to criticising either himself or his country. Australians would do well to remember that there are other standards of behaviour beside their own, and that it's possible that there is much to be said in favour of those other standards. Now, not every English captain has been as clear-sighted as Douglas Jardine was after his last series there. But, of course, just as you did, I consulted also Professor Google and looked up Australian character and discovered that there is, if you wish to go and live in Australia, I note, of course, that most Australians actually live in London now, but if you did wish to go and live in Australia, there is something called a character test. And one feature of it, and I quote absolutely accurately from the Australian government's website, an individual who is seeking entry into the country is not automatically disqualified from entry into Australia if they have been imprisoned in the past. There are many well-established Australian families who have reasons to be grateful that that dispensation was available in the past to their ancestors. But I thought perhaps it would be more useful, since we're in an academic institution of sorts, to look at what scholars have said on this subject. And there is, in fact, a book called Cricket and the National Identity in the Post-Colonial Age by somebody called Stephen Wagg, and you can find a helpful summary on the Macquarie University website. And he does discuss, in particular, what I call the leg theory series, and refers to the creation of the notion of the Aussie battler, surrounding the image of Bradman in that series, the notion of the kind of underdog who triumphs over the imperialist identity of the English, as it were, and identifies that as a kind of continuing feature of the way in which Australians think about themselves. And of course, as Bradman, my other son recently dug out some statistics which talked about the normalising tendency of cricket averages, but identified that Bradman's average is 4.4 standard deviations away from the mean of cricketers who play more than 50 tests.
You can tell you're an economist.
of sorts. But this sort of image born out of cricket and a particular cricketer, but also expanded into the way Australians think about themselves, is in fact the Stephen Wagg thesis. But interestingly, there's a contrasting thesis about the role of cricket in the English identity in a book called Globalising Cricket, Englishman, Empire and Identity by somebody called Dominic Malcolm, who argues that cricket has been annexed in the service of a particular definition of Englishness and empire, a game which is to be spread around the world, but also a rather exclusive game in which participation is highly valued, but not indiscriminately shared. And when we talk, he says, about cricket as the quintessential English game, we refer to the way cricket is an expression of the national consciousness. In other words, a sense of superiority is his argument. And he says it supports the idea of English, the English as a civilizing, peaceable people, and refers to the persistence of the view that the English, and thus their sport, are distinguished by their peaceable nature, which of course is a particular reading of English history, which not everybody would support. And indeed, in King's they have a rather distinguished Department of War Studies, which makes a living looking at the wars the English have perhaps wisely and unwisely gone in for. But this notion that cricket was part of the kind of civilising mission of the English around the world, and part, therefore, of an identity of Englishness that other people took on as part of this colonial mission, if you like, is one which I think persists. Though we, of course, have a view that we play the game in a slightly different way. And to quote two other distinguished academics, Flanders and Swan, who in their book, in their song, the Song of Patriotic Prejudice, the last verse is, "And as for the colonies, they're just the same. They've simply no notion of playing the game. They argue with umpires, they cheer when they've won, and they practice beforehand, which ruins the fun." Which I think expresses our view of the way this Australian team carries out. But interestingly, finally, Malcolm, in his book, looks at the way in which cricket has evolved in different countries, formerly parts of the British Empire, and noted that in the 18th century and early 19th century in the United States, cricket waned as a sport, and they then disengaged from cricket, and indeed, of course, from the empire, but that didn't happen in more straightforwardly colonial nations. So maybe we should conclude by thinking that Australia will have come of age when it gives up cricket and takes up baseball. Frankly, it can't come soon enough for me. Thank you.
English members in the audience, you may not be aware, but in Australia, on Australian TV, the newsreaders on the ABC had to have English accents up until the late 1970s, which brings me, Jim Maxwell, to the question of why is it that a sense of having a British accent or an English accent means that you automatically have a forensic knowledge of all things cricket?
Well, it's an interesting thought, and I was certainly brought up with a number of those people who did come from Britain, had served during the war, and were employed because they had those plummy English voices, because it was considered that these were pretty educated chaps, and they would have some grasp of audience and get the message across to them. And Martin Royal is certainly one name that sticks strongly in my memory. Who'd, I think, been bombed by the Germans during the war and managed to survive and went to Australia like a lot of others did, just 10-pound bombs or whatever. But for me, that connection is listening to Sir Robert Menzies when I was very young. He certainly was a cultured Australian voice, if not very much a plummy English voice, I suppose, if you want to talk about it in that way. And I remember Alan McGilvray, who was my predecessor, who definitely had a voice that was Alan McGilvray, it was no one else. It was coloured by 80 cigarettes a day and a number of cordials that he used to enjoy. But he had a lovely, intimate style of broadcasting. And he did this interview at Lord's in 1964 with Menzies, who, like John Howard and many other Australian Prime Ministers going back to Stanley, Melbourne, Bruce and so on, had a wonderful interest in the game. And John Curtin, who I should throw this in before we go any further in view of what's just happened at Lord's, because John Curtin was here in 1944 in the run-up to these famous victory test matches that they played. And I wrote it down so I wouldn't get it wrong. Australians will always fight for those 22 yards. Lord's and its traditions belong to Australians just as much as England. And you've seen pretty strong evidence of that in the last few days. So John Curtin was right on the money about that connection, because this ground up the road is almost our spiritual home of cricket, just as it is England's. And you only have to look at the record from 1938 until 2009 when we lost, and we didn't lose a test match at Lord's. So I think we've regained our territory. But Menzies spoke to McGilvray and complimented him on what he said about the game and about his impartiality and his decency, really. And he said, the most important thing, of course, McGilvray, is that not only do you give the score, but that you pause, because the pause is the most important aspect of giving a speech or doing cricket commentary. And that stuck with McGilvray. And I actually listened to some of his commentary the other day, because someone implored me to get out his early work, or his later work actually, during the famous West Indies series that you mentioned. And if you listen to that commentary, it is a wonderful example of using the crowd to highlight what's going on in the game. He was brilliant at that. And there were 90,000 people at the MCG, so he had a bit to work off. But he had this very cryptic style. And as a youngster, I was introduced to the Poms, as it were, by the radio. 1964 in particular sticks in my mind, because England had on the radio, on the BBC, John Arlott, who was a poet, and had wonderfully colourful descriptions of what was going on. And there were one or two other fellows who were a bit the same. But the truth was, and it sticks with me to this day, if you wanted to know what was going on in the game, you waited for McGilvray, because he knew the game inside out. And we still have a little bit of this going on in the box now, for those of you who listen. I mean, Henry Blofeld loves dirigibles and buses and pigeons and all sorts of stuff, which is wonderful colour. And Geoffrey Boycott certainly gives us an informed, if somewhat one-sided view of the game.
Is there as much sledging in the commentary box as what there is on the field?
At times, yes. I can get Geoffrey most of the time when Australia start to turn the screw, because he goes from gloating about what happened in Cardiff to absolutely burying them in the next moment. There's a saying apparently in Yorkshire with Geoffrey that you either hate him or you just don't like him. But I do enjoy the verbal jousts with Geoffrey. He's certainly knowledgeable. The atmosphere is outstanding in that box, I have to say. It's one of the friendliest places to be, even when we seem to win more often than we lose, I suppose, to England in the last 20 years. And it's been quite remarkable, actually, in this series to see what's occurring with the Australian side. But for me, the chance to do what I do is a privilege, to sit in front of all of you. Many learned people here who've done a lot with their lives. I'm just a cricket commentator. Give the score, pause, move on. Try to be impartial. And Clive Lloyd said to me years ago, he said, "Man, you're very fair." I said, "When we're getting thrashed, it's easy to be fair, Clive." So thank you for the invitation to be here tonight.
Thank you. Gideon Haigh, you were born in England, mm-hmm. raised in Australia.
Yeah.
You have an English father.
I have a Yorkshire father.
Oh, okay. And an Australian mother.
A Tasmanian mother.
So I'm interested in your take then, because you straddle the continents.
Well, yes, I feel as though I'm a bit of a... being sold as an Englishman here, I feel as though I'm a bit of an imposter. I'm sort of quiveringly ambivalent about Anglo-Australian relations, particularly around Ash's time. I was about 6 months after I was born, my Yorkshire grandparents went to a film evening, I think at the Wakefield Cricket Society, and they got Jeff Boycott's autograph for me. So it was almost as though I was born under his star sign. And this autograph was kept in the family until I was old enough to understand just how important it was. And then, of course, as a result, in Australia, I kind of grew up feeling a little bit like a Yorkshireman in an Australian's body. I was always the first to stand up for Jeff Boycott's reputation in debates with my fellow Australians. And then, of course, as a young journalist, I had the misfortune to meet him. You know what they say about you should never meet your heroes? Well, yes, he's an absolute tit. I do have a favourite Jeff Boycott recollection, Jim, and it was out the back of the TMS box in 2009 at Cardiff. I don't think anyone else heard him speaking as he did, but I heard him, and he was speaking very loudly into his mobile phone saying, "I didn't become a multimillionaire by being stupid." I don't know what it meant, but it sounded very much like my imaginings of Jeff Boycott. Also, Jim, I also went back to that same quote that you had recourse to earlier on, that John Curtin quote, which, as you said, was on his visit to England in 1944. It's funny, isn't it? Because John Curtin is regarded as the Prime Minister who tilted our interests or inclinations towards America. In fact, this is completely bogus. He was just as much of a fawning Anglophile as all the other prime ministers of his period. And I went, I of course, I looked up that famous speech of Curtin's in the City of London in 1944. I looked it up in Wisden, I might say, Wisden 1945, so I think I got the more accurate record of it, Jim. You go to Wisden for all important things like this. He said, "Lords, as to Australia, what it is to this country, we are defending the City of London and those 22 yards of hope of turf which we hope will be used time and time again, so that the motherland and Australia can decide whether the six ball over is better than the eight ball over." So Ashes cricket, I think, is a very, very important thing, but it's also a celebration of our great good fortune that allows us to be very, very trivial indeed. We decide the importance of the game. We imbue it with importance, and we're free to differ and at liberty to compete and even to thumb our noses at one another. Sir Robert Menzies was invoked before. He famously said, and I think put it beautifully, "Great Britain and Australia are of the same blood and allegiance and history and instinctive mental processes. We know each other so well that, thank heaven, we don't have to be too tactful with one another." Sport is still, I think, the most dynamic and demotic and enduring dimension of the relations between these two countries. And cricket is chief among the phenomena that keep us referring to the country that gave us birth. Interestingly, I suspect that Australia has historically had better cricketers than it has had politicians, because never let it be forgotten that at Federation, Australia had no anthem, it had no coinage, it had no official flag, it had no heraldry, it could not declare war or conclude peace treaties or be diplomatically represented, but it had already had a cricket team for 24 years. And of course, in the very act of creating an Australian cricket team, it entailed there having to be an England cricket team. Some of you will know that probably Australian cricket's first great triumph against English cricketers was at Lord's in 1878, when the Australian team bowled out Marylebone Cricket Club, led by W.G. Grace, for 33 and 19 in a single day's play. Frederick Spofford taking 11 wickets for 20. There's a very interesting report of that match in a newspaper called The World, where the correspondent says that already Australians Antipodeans have challenged English sporting supremacy. He was thinking of Ned Trickett's victory over Harry Sadlier, the English sculler in the Thames in 1876. But the correspondent went on to say, and now Australia has beaten England at Lord's. Now, in fact, they hadn't beaten England at Lord's at all. They'd only beaten the Marylebone Cricket Club. But the minute that you had one national team, you had to have another. So Australia can take credit for having conceived of international cricket in the first place, but perhaps the English can take credit for having put the idea in their minds for the first place by losing to them. Australian victory in those early days, of course, also expressed and assuaged the more aggressive strands of nationalism in our country. It indulged and contained the resentments that existed of the English, and provided, I think, for the substantive independence that the historian John Hirst has argued has helped to impede the push for symbolic independence. I look on Ashes cricket in the same way as what's the sporting equivalent of the 1931 Statute of Westminster, which allows Australia self-government within the Commonwealth, and in some respects has actually impaired our push towards republicanism. It is conceivable that in the future we will have cricket and republicanism, but perhaps that we have cricket already has eliminated the immediate need for a republican push. We already feel substantially independent from the UK, and we're disinclined to think that we need perhaps any more. There are also a great many English ideas embedded in Australian cricket, whether we like it or not. And it was interesting to hear Mr. Howard refer earlier on to the idea of the cricket tragic. I think this is actually a very English idea. Edmund Blunden, the English cricket writer, a very wonderful writer, once said that there is no sport that accords so much scope to the unreconstructed duffer as cricket. And I say thank God for that, having played 250 games with the South Yarra Cricket Club, which I always think of as a triumph of availability over ability. There is something about amateurism that even in these hyper-professional days is deeply embedded in the cricket consciousnesses of both countries. I mean, what proportion of Australians last summer would have been paid for the cricket that they played? Probably closer to 0.1% than 1%. A third of Australians, according to the last statistical data, competed in some form of athletic endeavour in the previous 12 months, put together by some amateur association. So despite the professional gloss that's on the game, we still have a deeply embedded idea of sport for its own sake. This also allows me the opportunity to tell you my favourite joke about amateurism, which is a line by Randy Spears, the porn star, who once said that he was able to work up lust for 30% of the women that he had sex with in his films. The rest of the time, he was just being a professional. I think the other thing about the evolving relations between the two countries, and it was interesting to hear John refer earlier on to the data around the relations or the regard that Australians continue to have towards England, is I think that one of the reasons why Ashes cricket has come into its own, probably even over the last 20 or so years, when it's cloaked itself in an increasingly patriotic raiment, is it prospers because of misgivings about the relations that we have with our newer, noisier, more aggressive and more superficial ally in the United States. We resent the Poms, but we relish our companionable rivalry with England. We're deluged by American cultural influences, yet we feel faintly peevish about them and their dominance in our culture. 20 years ago, I can remember being in the back of a cab in San Diego, trying helplessly to explain cricket to an American. And I remember clinching the argument by saying, and you know, sometimes it can go for 5 days and they don't get a result. And the silence that followed was absolutely cavernous. I thought, Australia and the US, we're just never going to understand one another. And thank God for that.
Thanks. We're going to open the floor to questions now, and so I want you all to put on your thinking caps, and we've got an incredible panel that you can pose some real teasers to them, I think. But I'll just kick it off because I'm interested in the fact that Michael Clarke denied the England team entry into the Australian dressing room to have a beer. What does this mean about Australia-England relationships? And what does this mean about dressing room protocols? I'd like to perhaps ask Jim Maxwell that one.
Well, I think Jimmy Anderson was probably out of order. I don't know what had got into him. Was he throwing out some olive branch after the fracas? The sledging episode from Brisbane last year, he wanted to make an early start to some new found diplomacy that he had in mind, because the tradition is you go in at the end of the series and have a drink.
Well, it's not the tradition, because I was talking to Mike Atherton this morning, and he said when he started his career, they had a drink in the opposition dressing room every night.
Yes. And in Ian Chappell's day, I think the same.
Well, that's right. And then he said towards the end of his career, it became towards the end of every test. Mm. And now it's the end of every series. Yeah. I find that kind of...
Jimmy Anderson was probably doing the right thing.
Yeah, maybe he was.
And he got knocked off at the pass, didn't he? Yes.
Wasn't there a situation, though, where one of the players went into the dressing room and then wrote a book about what went on, and that was seen as a major mark of disrespect as to...
Was that in Adelaide?
Yeah, that was the where Damian Martin's alleged to have said to Anderson that he couldn't stand Michael Clarke.
Yes.
May not be on his Pat Malone there.
I thought it was that they'd invited the Australians into the English cricket team, into the English dressing room, and they thought the beer would be warm.
Okay, now who's got some questions for us? Yes, if we can... can you just wait for the microphone, because we are recording this, and so your words of wisdom will be heard on ABC Radio.
I was just wondering, given the comments in the papers today about the first Aboriginal cricket side that toured England and their demonstration of not just their fielding skills but their skills with their traditional weapons, etc., and how the only English cricketer at the time that could match them was W.G. Grace, that perhaps the England MCC had made an error of judgment in choosing their latest coach, having passed over one of our most famous Indigenous cricketers in Jason Gillespie.
Right, we'll throw that one to Sir Howard.
Well, you know, the guy they brought in, I mean, he's terrific. I mean, he invented that radio, didn't he? That wind-up radio, which is an amazing thing to have done. So I'm hoping that he'll do a lot for our team. But so far, I guess, we have to say that the jury's out after Lords would perhaps be the kindest way of putting it.
Are the English offended that they have to go to Australia to find somebody to coach their team?
No. I mean, you know, we've got a non-domiciled Canadian as the governor of a Bank of England. You know, we don't. We've given up.
But Mr. Howard, could you perhaps talk about the Aboriginal team coming over here and how cricket really helped form Australia's identity, didn't it? I mean, in forming, you know, they were the first national side. They still are the main code in Australia that brings together all the states.
Yeah, it was the only major sport, team sport, that does that. I think it's fair to say that the great strength that Australian rules has in the Australian rules playing states is that, like cricket, it crosses all the demographics, whereas the rugby code says... Historically, have had this sort of two streams, although they're coming together a lot now. Look, I think the story of the Aboriginal team is fascinating, but and it's nice to be reminded about it. But I'm not sure that cricket early on was as welcoming, or perhaps the opportunities for Indigenous people in cricket perhaps was not as great. And my instinct is that the sport in Australia that's done the best with Indigenous involvement has probably been Australian rules. I think they've done, for a whole combination of reasons, they've done quite a good job. But mean, I think that's a lovely story, but you have to understand that it didn't automatically translate into a large number of Indigenous people. But the participation of Aborigines in Australian sporting teams mirrored the story of Indigenous people in this country. Yeah, some of them, their identity as Indigenous just was not known, and so I don't think we can draw any particular significance. I mean, if you want to be objective about it, I don't think you draw any particular significance from it.
But if you look at cricket now, they're white, middle class men, usually.
Yeah, but okay. I think cricket's done it well. Yes, but gee whiz, every time I see an Australian of Indian background, they've got a cricket bat. I mean, really, this idea that look, we've got somebody of Islamic faith in the touring team, somebody who's born in Pakistan. Look, these things will come naturally. I have not seen in anything I've seen over the last 10 or 20 years, or even more, I've never seen any barriers put in the way of somebody in cricket because their name is not Smith or Kelly or McDonald. I think we shouldn't get hung up about this. It will just happen naturally, and the game appeals to people of a non-Anglo Celtic ethnicity. Well, that's terrific. If it doesn't, they won't play it. I think we just ought to take our cue from that.
We have Usman Khawaja, yeah, who was here 2 years ago, is now captain of the Australian A team, which is touring India. He was born in Islamabad. We have Gurinder Sandhu, mm-hmm, whose father's a taxi driver out in Penrith, and he's got two very talented cricketers after he emigrated to Australia. So I think the next generation, you're going to see more of the a mix beyond Anglo-Celtic names.
But do you think that Australia adapts more and is more inclusive of other people other than white middle-class people, or rather than England?
I think in sport it is. I think sport is not bad at all. Mm. Certainly over the last 10 years at my club, I've seen us go from nowhere to probably having about 25% of our players coming from South Asia. And they're terrific cricketers because they're not interested in anything else. If they don't want to watch the footy, they're happy to play cricket all year.
Okay, who would like to ask a question? Yes, sir.
What can the panel tell us about the history and role of sledging, and perhaps the propensity of a team to sledge tells us about the culture?
Can I just say we're entering a new era in Australian cricket with the coming of Neville and the going of Haddon. There would not be a more undemonstrative, shy wicketkeeper, I reckon, in 100 years in Australian cricket than Peter Neville. You can wind up the stump microphone as much as you want, and all you'll hear is him scratching around behind the stumps. He never says a word. So this is a brand new slant on the game. It's unheard of that a wicketkeeper at some point isn't going to tell a rather large fella that he's a fat so-and-so or whatever. I don't know how well this is going to pan out. Maybe our cricket will be the poorer for it if we're not having a wicketkeeper who can sledge. But I just think the whole thing with sledging, and I mean, it's the funny side of it that's better than someone telling a player, the captain telling he's going to break his arm and everything else. There are lots of good yarns around, but I think the media just love latching onto it as a story. But it's a sideshow. It rarely happens, but when it does, it blows up into the biggest thing of all time. But most of the time, I think it's pretty tame out there, unless someone's getting wounded or offended, and that doesn't happen over the course of 30 hours of cricket very often, does it?
So if Australia's going to be these silent assassins now, what is England going to do? Mm. How are they going to respond to this, Sir Howard?
It was Terry Allen, wasn't it?
Yes,
Terry Allen.
He was tackled. Well, he was tackled by an Englishman in Perth, famously. That was probably one of the worst incidents on the field. But there was only one player involved, and he ended up dislocating his shoulder. Yes, that was a bad moment, but you know, it wasn't like Bodyline. I don't know what are England going to do? This is a very good question.
I think we will respond with characteristic dignity, discretion and good humour.
Do you think the sport needs comedy villains? It seems a preponderance, you know, we've had Mitchell Johnson in the test before, you know, Australia's eye is on the case of Jimmy Anderson, and of course there's been the Kevin Peterson debacle in the last couple of years. Does cricket and the whole dynamic between England and Australia need those comedy villains?
Well, it gets them, and I suppose partly because, I mean, and I say this as a cricket tragic, just like John Howard, but, you know, just be clear, there are lots and lots of hours in a cricket match where nothing happens. You have to write about something and talk about something, and so I think people do build up characters out of perhaps not a great deal, but that's fine, that's part of the theatre.
I don't think I'd ever realised how different the nature of English and Australian cricket was until I played here a game in 2009. And I remember going out to bat and just thinking, my God, it's silent out here. Come on, someone sledge me, for God's sake. And I found it actually quite difficult to switch on. I was so used to sledging being a kind of background noise. And it was a very cunning plan because I very quickly got myself out as I struggled to work my way into it competitively. So maybe that's the solution. We'll see who can bear the silence longest.
There's a gentleman up the back there. Yes.
Great. Just a question to Jim Maxwell about the best player you've seen play and what particular spell would actually back that up or that you've seen. And a quick follow-up to Mr. Howard. I very much enjoyed all of your stints in the commentary box over the summer. It was a great highlight. But just to draw attention to that particular bowl that you bowled and you got a lot of flack for, I was just worrying, what was the follow-up ball or the practice ball? How did they come out?
Hey, you go first, Ron.
You
think of an
think
answer.
Think of that one, yes. Yeah. Yes, I think Kerry O'Keefe called you the king of spin, didn't he? But he wasn't talking about your bowling. best. Sticking to the Anglo-Australian cricket in the context of the best. Gee. I'll tell you one player who gets forgotten, particularly on this one innings I remember because I was here at Lords in 1972. I was playing cricket at Lords and, you know, Bob Massey put on probably one of the greatest displays of swing bowling that's ever been seen. Mm. He bowled around the wicket and he was getting left-handers out, swinging the ball late away. It was overcast for 3 or 4 days. It was his first test. No one had ever seen him. And he bowled these extraordinary wicket-taking and deliveries. But what I'm getting to is that in that same game, one of the best hundreds ever made in a test match was compiled by Greg Chappell. He got 131, but you know, a bit like Arthur Morris's 196 at the Oval, no one remembers it because Bradman got out for a duck. Arthur loves to tell the story about that, of course, someone asked him many years later, were you there in 1948? Where were you? I was at the other end. Oh, did you get any runs? He said, I got 196 run out. You can pick anything out in terms of marvellous batting performances, but Greg Chappell's classic style, you know, standing straight and hitting the ball wide of mid-on, and the way he played Illingworth, particularly in that series and at other times, the way he played spin bowling, very quick on his feet. He was a stellar player. But, ask me a question again in 10 minutes and I'll probably come with someone else. But I'll never forget that. That innings and that bowling. There's never been bowling, swing bowling like that in our lifetime.
Can I just say before I get to that terrible ball that I in Anglo-Australian tests, I tend to share Jim's view. I think Greg Chappell as a sheer stylist is just absolutely outstanding. I really do. Look, there's a long story associated with that ball. It really goes back to the fact that when it comes to contest between Australia and England, Pakistan is on our side. Because after we lost the Ashes in 2005, I went to a UN meeting in New York, and I wandered over, Tony Blair was over there, and I thought I should do the right thing. I wandered over to him and said, "Congratulations, Tony." And Tony virtually didn't know what I was talking about because he didn't really follow much cricket. Tony was more a tennis and a soccer man. Anyway, Pervez Musharraf, the president of Pakistan, and he got the presidency of that country through a slightly different route than I got the prime minister. But, you know, and he lost it in a slightly different way too, but we'll gloss over that. He was, you know, he was absolutely devoted to cricket. I remember the last time I spoke to him before I was kicked out as Prime Minister, it was late in 2007. I rang him to sort of say that I didn't think it was a particularly good idea to remove Chief Justices and it made it very difficult sometimes for his friends. But before we got on to that, he spent about 10 minutes talking about cricket at the beginning of the conversation. But anyway, Pervez Musharraf came racing over to me and he saw me talking to Tony Blair, and he knew what it was about. He says, John, he says, do not worry, we will avenge you. And and God bless them, they did. Because England went to Pakistan later, I think in 2005 or 6, and they did beat England, and that was good. But one of the reasons I mentioned that is that after that terrible earthquake in Pakistan that devastated Kashmir, I organised to send an Australian military medical team to Kashmir, and I visited them when I went to Pakistan later that year, and you had some Pakistani army people there. They had organised a game with the local kids, and they had this ball that was composed of the inside of a tennis ball and some white tape around it, and sort of, you know, Muggins couldn't resist when he was thrown and said, "Go on," and you know, he had Dougie Ferguson and all the fellows from the Channel 9 say, "Go on, John, Prime Minister, have a go." I mean, this is, so of course I had a go and it stuck in my hand, it looked awful. And of course it played forever and a day afterwards, but it was quite an uplifting sort of experience. It had this terrible devastation, and, you know, thousands of people killed, and there's one poor Pakistani lady who was a doctor. She'd lost her husband and 3 children in the earthquake, but she was toiling away with the Australian army team helping these poor people, and you had these kids playing cricket. And the devotion of anybody on the subcontinent to cricket is just extraordinary. It's the one part of the world that doesn't freeze during a soccer World Cup. you can still get a flight at Lahore, or soccer World Cup's on, you can still get a flight. I tried to get a flight out of San Paulo while the soccer World Cup was on, and, you know, very difficult because everybody was watching the soccer. So it's amazing, and whatever, we have plenty of Indian subcontinental migration to Australia, that's a rich stream for cricket in our country.
I would also, I'd add that John's contribution to the cricket vernacular goes beyond the mere word tragic. Over the course of cricket history, various neologisms have been coined to describe particular deliveries. BJT Bosanquet gave us the Bosie, Saqlain Mushtaq gave us the Dusra, Ellis Achong gave us the Chinaman. But even now, bowl a half tracker that lands at your feet in Melbourne club cricket and you'll be known as doing a John Howard.
Mention of the Chapel brothers there, and I'm just interested in the English perspective of the famous, infamous incident of the bowling underarm back in 1981. And Sir Howard, I'm just interested in whether you think that if an Australian hadn't done that, whether an Englishman would have eventually.
I don't think that it surprises us at all. It's exactly what we would expect of an Australian circumstances. Actually, I looked at it the other day on YouTube, and it's sort of jokey, isn't it? I mean, it was a bit of a joke at the time. It wasn't really particularly serious because there was no possibility of them winning. So I think we cheerfully overplayed it. But I mean, it feeds our prejudices.
I was going to say, sir, how there was a case of an English one-day game involving Somerset and Worcestershire in 1979, where Brian Rose, the Somerset captain, declared Somerset's first innings at 0-1 because they had to. They were going to get through. Were going to qualify on run rate. And deliberately lost the game. Worcestershire made none for two. The game was over in two overs. And so the English had the idea first, maybe.
Because they got up there. Yeah.
Okay, if we can just go up the back here. Yes, please.
A request, first of all, from my son, Jim. I asked him what the score was early on, I can't remember which innings, for England. And he went to the radio, listened for a bit, and he came back and said, England are 2-9. And he turned the radio off and didn't listen to the rest of the match because he assumed we were listening. I just, while you're on TMS, could you do it the other way around like we do? Because young boys don't care. It was just a question really on, so after Cardiff, I'm intrigued to know how the Australians thought your team would respond and recover. And here we are after Lords. How do we feel the England team are going to turn around and recover, and what does that say about us?
Well, Darren Lehman said the first test was a hiccup. I'm not sure what Trevor Bayliss is saying about the second test, but it looked to be a bit more than a hiccup, I suppose, from England's point of view. I see they've brought Johnny Bairstow in for the next test, and they've dropped Gary Balance. So who knows? Someone wins the toss and bats, and they win the game. This seems to be happening more and more, although Andrew Sampson came up with a very interesting statistic.
Yeah.
Did you see that one today? No. Since the last 20 years of Test cricket, there have been X number of teams who have won the toss and X number of teams have lost the toss, and it's about 350 apiece in terms of the result. Mm. So maybe we're reading too much into all of that. But I think Australians will be interested to see if there's any grass on the surface that's not smashed in and if there's much bounce in the pitch. Because if Mitchell Johnson had his redemptive moment at Lord's, from 2009 when he went round the park and bowled bombs the other day. Wow, what about Edgbaston 2005 when McGrath trod on a ball before the start of play and we lost by 2 runs. So I'm sure, you know, our chaps will be motivated and all that sort of stuff, but I think it's going to be fascinating to listen to it, to watch it, and whether the score's 9-2 or 2-9. Just on that, you know why that happens. It's your scoreboards and our scoreboards. Mm. It's the way you present the score historically on those scoreboards that don't have any information on them. That's why you buy a scorecard. good business. Whereas in Australia, it's always been the wickets and the runs, and England is the other way around. I'm sure that's the genesis of the difference in the description. So, you know, when it's 5-5, we're safe.
So, Howard, how do you think that the English will respond to 405-run defeat?
Well, I can't say I'm enormously optimistic. And the one selection change, I'm afraid that David Morgan's money is at play here. He's now bought the selectors because the change, the idea that the response to that defeat is to put a man who is averaging 11 in the last 12 test matches in at number 3. I find it's a joke, and I think that what we've got trapped in is a kind of, you know, there are still some people in the team who are there on past record, and somehow they can't bring themselves to drop them. And so I think that I've written off Edgbaston already. I can't see any chance of our recovering at Edgbaston whatsoever. I think the team has got as much chance of winning at Edgbaston as I have of winning this debate with four players against me, when I was told this was a 2+2 and a neutral umpire, and I've got 2+1 Australians and an Australian commentator. So these odds are stacked against me, and I think they're stacked against England at Edgbaston.
Now, I think, David Morgan, you should have the right of reply here.
Well, thank you, Jackie. I'm delighted to see this panel here tonight, including my boss of 35 years ago, John Howard, Gideon Haigh, wonderful sports and business writer, and that wonderful voice of Jim Maxwell's. So I'm delighted to see all of you. With Howard, it is a sense of relief to see him here tonight, massive relief. Because from about early on the third day of the Cardiff test, I was bombarded by contact from Howard. Absolutely bombarded. Emails, phone calls, calling around at my house at night. Then I tried to reciprocate around just after tea on the Lord's test, and he was completely uncontactable. Email, phone, I went round to his home. I was seriously worried he'd been done in. So I'm very glad you're here, Howard. You might sense a slight strain of competitiveness from Howard about Australia, but I think I need to come to his defence. He had a particularly difficult experience at Australia Customs when he tried to get through, and I asked him if he had a criminal conviction, and Howard, in his charming way, said, "I thought that had long since stopped being a qualification for getting into a country." I'm a collector of rare books, and a friend of mine recently gave me what purported to be a copy of Jardine's book on the Bodyline series, which I quickly but thoroughly read. And the version I had no mention of the word bodyline, so I assume that's a bogus copy. Can someone help me find where I get a genuine copy of that book, please?
Gideon, I think you're the...
Well, it's an Australian... The term itself, of course, is an Australian invention, and it's a trans... It's because of the custom in those days of using cablees to save money. You used to send your copy to your office in cables, and you would run words together in order to, because you were charged per word, which used to result in sort of compound words being used. There is a famous story, actually, of a African correspondent to a Fleet Street newspaper, where he was sent a cable asking why he hadn't filed a story recently, and he replied, "Unnews, good news, no news, good news," and his office replied, "Unnews, unjob." And the correspondent replied, "Up stuff job arsewards." The story is that it was actually Hugh Buggy, the Australian correspondent for, I think, the Herald newspaper, used the expression "fast pitch balls on the body line." And he compressed body line together. And Ray Robinson, who was the sub in the Herald office at the time, just liked it so much that he let it go through. In those days, it was lowercase, and it was in inverted commas, but of course, over the period of history, it's become uppercase and a noun in its own right.
Okay, and the gentleman there in the middle row. Is there anyone up the back there that'd like to ask a question? I haven't seen any hands up there. Maybe next time.
Lest we forget, the last time Australia thrashed England at Lord's, 10 days later England won at Edgbaston and went on to win the series. So what specific Australian characteristic and what specific English characteristic might now be needed to secure the Ashes this time?
What do you think, Mr. Howard?
I would have thought, after watching the last 4 days, continuity. Which is a very desirable Australian characteristic. Look, I think there is still a psychological problem with the Australian pace attack as far as English batsmen are concerned. That's the impression I have. They do give the impression, and I'm not saying this in any sort of triumphal way. They do give the impression have been just a little bit spooked by our bowling attack in the way I can remember as a, you know, as a 14-year-old boy thinking that the Australian middle order batting in 1954 was spooked by Frank Tyson and Brian Statham when they annihilated us on that visit. You do get these, you know, these phases. And, I mean, it must be quite, if you're looking at it very analytically, it must be quite daunting for the Englishman to see this in one after the other. The loss of Ryan Harris was a big blow, and yet we've got people who can come up to the plate. I thought Mitchell Marsh, I never had any idea he bowled so fast. I thought he was a fast medium or medium fast, but he was very. So I think that's the biggest problem. I don't think the Englishman can handle our pace attack. And there, I mean, if I were the English team, I'd put Root in at number three. I think they have to do. I've noticed they brought in Bairstow. I understand the point that Howard's made. His average is cricket is not too good. But then they, you know, were very, very early order batting of England in the last 4 days has been, and I think they just have a problem with our pace attack. So to the extent that Australia can maintain that kind of psychological as well as actual ascendancy, it's going to be very hard for England to recover. And I don't think grabbing hold of the other, and I think the circumstances are different. It's, you know, it's like every election campaign, the issue is always different. If you try and win the next election on the strength of the policy you took to the previous one, you're bound to lose.
I think England need to take a leaf out of Warwick Armstrong's method many years ago when there was a break and he came back and he ended up bowling at both ends. And I think if Stuart Broad bowls at both ends, England's got a chance.
So, Howard, do you think that there's pressure on the captaincy now with Alistair Cook? You know, England have stuck with him for a very, very long time, and there were question marks about his batting. He's kind of answered those. But do you think that his very conservative nature is by reflecting the English nature, but do you need a change?
Personally, I don't think so. I thought his captaincy at Cardiff was excellent, and I didn't think that at Lord's captaincy was the issue. He had nothing to play with. You know, I think once you'll let the opposition get away at more than 550, there's not a lot you can do. I mean, you can argue a couple of chances went through third slip when he'd taken third slip out, but if you're up against 550, you know, I mean, it is difficult. I think this is difficult. Mm. I honestly don't think that we would find a better captain than Cook. I personally would think, one, that I think our pace attack is not that bad. I can't believe that Anderson has suddenly finished, and I think he will come back in this series. And at some point he will stop, but I think he'll reasonably come good. But I think that if we want to win another test match, I think we will have to take a chance on playing a bowler, a more aggressive spinner of the ball, because I think we need to try something different. I would give Rashid a chance. I would have put keep Moeen in, put him up the order, just drop balance, put in Rashid, put Bairstow in for Bell, and I think you'd have a better chance because you'd have something different to throw at the Australians. Not convinced we'd win, but I think it would be worth a try.
Interesting. And we have a question up at the back now. And we'll just take, I think, two more questions. So first, with their hands up,
It's tough being English. I'm 33 and probably only for the first two-thirds of my kind of cricketing career, if you want to call it that, it's been really hard work. And it's only in the last 10 years, since 2005, that I've actually had something to enjoy and get excited about. But there's been many Australian players over the years that, I guess, through gritted teeth, I've had to admire. And you know, just recently I was watching an overview of Glenn McGrath, and it brings up those old memories of how he used to rip our top order apart. So I'd be interested to know which players from the opposition have you admired and kind of hated to love over the years?
Gideon?
It's a lot of that in the Ashes, isn't there? I guess that goes back to Neville Carter's famous prayer as a young boy in Manchester. He grew up and used to finish his prayers by saying, "Dear God, please let Victor Trumper score 100 for Australia tomorrow out of an all-out score of 137. There are usually some members of the opposition who you don't mind too much if they do well. Glenn McGrath is an interesting example. Glenn McGrath ruined a day of cricket for me as a reporter. I remember being at the at Lord's in 2005 and watching England lauded over Australia in the first two sessions. Bowled them out cheaply by tea time. The England team walked off to a standing ovation. That, of course, was the obvious story of the day, so I immediately commenced to writing it and wrote an absolutely scintillating piece for The Guardian about this England storm into dominance in the Ashes, and by stumps, England was 7 for 92. Thanks very much, Glenn McGrath. I had to scrap the piece and write about him instead. It's the best piece I've ever written that was never published. And I guess for me, as an England supporter abiding, despite my ambivalent relations with the country, the player who's given me the most excitement has been Shane Warne. I feel incredibly fortunate to have lived through the Shane Warne era and to have seen the possibilities of leg spin, which when I was growing up in Australia never seemed a possibility. You got people, old-timers, who talked about leg spin, and they talked about the marvellous leg spin bowlers that you see, but your temptation was just to say, well, that's very nice, old man, but there is no place for leg spin in the modern game. And then all of a sudden, you know, there he was in our midst, a kind of a myth made flesh, the ultimate leg spinner, the ultimate evolutionary specimen of leg spin, who did it all so easily and so marvellously. And I've written a book about Shane, and the reason that I did so is because I wanted to be able to explain to the next generation just how exciting it was to see a player like that, and to intimate to people who perhaps didn't have the experience what an extraordinary event it was simply to see Shane Warne come on and bowl.
So Howard, who do you think?
Australians I admire. I used to. I quite liked the look of Sam Robson for a while.
Martin McKay.
But as a Lancastrian, the two Australians I admire are Ken Greaves, whom I was brought up on, who played for Lancashire for about 15 years, was absolutely marvellous, and Stuart Law, possibly the most unlucky Australian. He scored well in his only test match and was never picked again. But Lancashire benefited because he played many years for us and scored a mountain of runs. So they're my favourite Australians.
Oh, very easy, Ian Botham. Botham was a great player. He had a real touch of the Keith Miller about him. And he could turn a game around. He was good bloke. I thought he was a very exciting player, and I never minded both of them getting some runs and getting some wickets, because he was a champion player, and I think he contributed a lot to the enjoyment of the game. So he's top of my list of English players. Another one I admired, I'm dating myself, Ken Barrington. Barrington was a remarkable accumulator of runs. He was an extraordinarily effective player. I respected him enormously. Wasn't flashy, but gee, he was reliable. But they're the two, Barrington and Botham.
I think Barrington also kind of an incarnation of a very particular kind of Englishness.
Yeah.
Ken Mackay, I think, once said that when Barrington came out to bat, you could see the Union Jack trailing behind him.
He was very hard to shift. And he was
huge average too, about 50 years.
Oh, extraordinary average. Barrington was a remarkable player.
Well, Flintoff most recently, of course. His bowling in 2005 was just phenomenal. But you know, I go back to my youth, as it were, and watching John Snow and Freddie Trueman, two outstanding bowlers who weren't always selected, of course, by the MCC. But I can still see Freddie Trueman back in 62 at the SCG. He bowled Bill Laurie a bouncer, the very first ball of Australia's innings, and there's a huge mob on the hill. By then they were pretty much intoxicated. It was after tea. And like Lords in those days, and at the SCG you could take your own grog in, and they used to take it in these Eskies, in these steel cans, and throw it down. So they gave him a burst, and he handled it superbly. He looked towards the hill, and he did this wonderful bow, and he just walked back, and he had him from then on. But those characters, rich characters, particularly Fred Truman, who I was lucky enough to work with as well, you know, what's going off out here? Was the usual line when Freddie didn't quite get what was happening on the ground. But nobody comes back to fast bowlers when you're looking at characters like our Tomo, of course, who can still, if he was on the stage now, he could put his wrist on the floor without bending his knees. He's still a piece of rubber. Amazing man. Yeah.
Well, talking of taking a bow, I'd like to thank you all for coming tonight, and I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have, just sitting here listening to the gentleman either side of me. And we are going to have a few drinks next door, and I'm sure you'll have many more questions that you'd like to ask them. So I'd just like to thank you very much for coming and introduce you back to Dr. Henderson for his closing remarks.
Thanks very much, Jackie, and I'm really just here to say some thank yous and to direct you towards a drink. I won't be a moment, but just bear with me for this. Pilchard begins his long run from short stump. He bowls and, oh, he's out, yes, he's got him. Long Willie has caught leg before in middle slops by Grattan. That's definitely one for the books, Bruce. I don't think I've seen an offside medium slow fast-paced bowling to match it since Baden Powell took Rangatunga for a maiden over at Bangalore in 1948.
Bryson.
Well, that was the American Bill Bryson satirising, for him, the impenetrable cricketing commentary in his book Down Under from 2000. And just about any Australian child would spot the deliberate mistakes in Bryson's vocabulary. What that shows is the saturation of our national culture in the language and the style of cricket. But as Bryson's wit underscores, it's also an international language, registering a cricketing way of being in the world. One that in many ways realises the egalitarian aspirations of the Commonwealth, drawing out similarities of culture across national borders and across those more insidious divisions of wealth, class and ethnicity. So no matter the sledging that's gone on slightly this evening, we've been reasonably well behaved on the pitch, and on the pitch, Australia and England are cousinly in their relations, as in the case when any cricketing nations meet. As has been also reflected in tonight's marvellous conversation, it's really a matter of family rivalry rather than cultural war. I hope you've enjoyed tonight's conversation as much as I have. It's the third in our series. We've spoken about financial sector reform in the past. We had a conversation with the British Museum about Indigenous art. Our next conversation, and look out for this probably in November, will ask how federalism has served Australia and what it might do for, or what it might do to, Britain. I'm sure many people here tonight could make some choice contributions to that discussion. I don't doubt, for example, that negotiations with state governments are a genuine pleasure for any Australian Prime Minister. So, in a moment, I will ask you to join us simply next door, so you can go out either of these doors on either side of the hall, turn right and move into the next room, which is the Great Hall, where we'll very much enjoy the catering from King's Catering and the wonderful wine supplied by negotiants. Before that, a few thank yous. I'd like to thank Catherine Batterby, Vanessa Steinman and their team from Australian Business. It's been wonderful working with them again for tonight's conversation. A big thank you to the team at King's, Pelagia Pace, Laura Douglas, Abby Gerrard and Alex Creighton, who've helped so much set up tonight. A big thank you also to the Menzies Centre Chair, John Douth, Board Member Ros Kelly and Kathy Taylor, who have been instrumental in making tonight come together. And of course, a big thank you to this evening's sponsors, Westpac, and it's great to see so many of the Westpac team here this evening. And finally, last but not least, please give a very rousing thank you and thanks so much for this wonderful conversation to our speakers tonight, Mr. John Howard, Sir Howard Davies, Gideon Haigh, Jim Maxwell and Jacquelin Magnay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.